We arrive at this year's Thanksgiving service in a month that is dedicated to exploring how our Unitarian, Universalist history and theology compels us to action today. It is common to spend the Sunday before Thanksgiving reflecting on the role of gratitude in our lives. My hope is that we'll be able to find a balance between the tough reality of our past and the gratitude that we hold for our present. For those of you who heard Don't Drink the Water by the Dave Matthews Band for the first time today, I know it can be a lot to take in. How many of you have never heard that song before? Okay, that song came out when I was in high school. So I'm glad to know that it's new for a lot of folks. It's a lot to take in, so let's unpack it just a little bit. So the song addresses the subjugation and slaughter of the indigenous peoples of this land. It references the times that the colonists were unable to drink water from rivers and streams because it had been tainted by the blood of the people they had killed. People who were killed in the name of building a promised land where their killers could have religious freedom. This was a common occurrence in the brave new world that the Pilgrims and Puritans built. We heard echoes of it in William Bradford's account. He said that the blood of the heathens, quote heathens, was so great that it quenched the fire that the Pilgrim militia had set to the village that they, the Pilgrims, had destroyed. And that sounds like bravado, but it's not. It's hard to hear this. I know it's hard to hear this. We've grown accustomed to thinking about Thanksgiving and the founding of our country in a very different way. We want to believe the stories of pilgrims and the Wampanoag people living in peace, but friends, that is simply not true. It's important for us to talk about this honestly. We owe it to ourselves and we owe it to those who died to tell the truth about our history, both the history of the United States and the history of our Unitarian Universalist tradition. As Americans and as UUs, we want to believe that we have always been a righteous, benevolent people, but again, that is simply not true. It is not true now. It was not true then. We really can never be a righteous, benevolent people if we are ignorant about our history or if we try to justify its odious chapters. If we really want to be who we say we are, both as a country and a religion, we have got to stop gaslighting ourselves about who we are and where we have come from. Can't stop being something if you can't say what that something is. A few weeks ago, we dug into the Calvinist roots both of the United States and of Unitarianism. We looked at how that theology undergirds the institutional structures of our nation that divide people into groups of good and bad, deserving and undeserving, human, subhuman. That thinking was part of the theology and the culture of the Pilgrims and the Puritans, and it was thus written into the founding documents of our nation. And over time, some of those Calvinist Pilgrims and Puritans evolved into Unitarians. And as UUs, we are unlikely to condemn someone to hell, as our Calvinist forebears did, but we still find ways of subjugating and otherizing. Oppression and privilege still operate in our circles in a less tangible, more insidious way. And the Mayflower Compact is the starting point, the founding documents of our country and our religious tradition that demonstrate and in-group, out-group mentality. We trace our roots back further than this, but the Mayflower Compact plays a particularly important role, both in the founding of America and in Unitarianism. Specifically, the Mayflower Compact is often considered to be the seminal covenant from which our covenantal faith grew. The Pilgrims had varying beliefs that might seem nominal to the modern observer, but were a very big deal at the time. And the Mayflower Compact held them together while allowing them to maintain those varying beliefs. It balanced cooperation with religious freedom. The heart of the Mayflower Compact, with a few edits for clarity, reads as follows. We solemnly and mutually in the presence of God and one another covenant and combine ourselves together in a civil body politic for our better ordering and preservation and furtherance of the colony, and the virtue and by virtue of hereof enact, constitute, and frame such just and equal laws, ordinances, acts, constitutions, and offices from time to time as shall be thought most meet and convenient for the general good of the colony, unto which we promise all due submission and obedience. Ta-da! You can see how important it is, right? So it's a little lackluster when you just read it. But it was very important. It's a landmark in world and religious history. It became the cornerstone of congregational polity. Congregational polity is the system of governance that UU churches and other Christian denominations use. Congregational polity, based on the model derived from the Pilgrims, first articulated in the Mayflower Compact, is what allows us to have the freedom to decide our own way of being a church. No one sends UU churches a minister, we call them. No one tells UU churches how to do business, we shape that ourselves. No one tells us what to believe or how to have a worship service or what we can do in a worship service. And all of that stems from the Mayflower Compact. It was a statement of free cooperation between people who had differing beliefs, just like we have in our modern UU churches. We, like our Pilgrim forebears, are held in bonds of mutual consent, not mutual belief. As such, the Mayflower Compact served to create a free and equitable environment for the Pilgrims, and it did not extend in any way to the people who were already living on this continent or anybody else who came later, who wasn't a Calvinist Pilgrim like them. Based on their Calvinist beliefs, the Pilgrims did not consider the indigenous people of this land as people at all. They were heathens, destined for hell. Nothing about them mattered, especially how they were treated or how they died. I hope that we're all familiar with the way that the indigenous people of this continent have been treated over the centuries. The United States government has famously upheld none of the treaties that it has entered into with them. They were forced into smaller parcels of land in undesirable places. They were targeted for biological warfare when our government intentionally sent them blankets exposed to smallpox. They were denied traditional means of gathering sustenance for themselves and were sent aid packages containing rotting meat. Their children were forced into rehabilitation schools where they were exposed to every level of abuse. And to add insult to injury, they have become reduced to stereotypes and caricatures serving as school and sports mascots. I want to provide you with some numbers to help you conceptualize this. There are differing approaches to determining the number of First Nations peoples who died due to interactions with Europeans. Aaron McKenna and Scott L. Pratt take a broad approach in their 2015 book titled American Philosophy, From the Knee to the Present. They write, indigenous people north and south were displaced, died of disease, and were killed by Europeans through slavery, rape, and war. 1991, about 145 million people lived in the Western Hemisphere. By 1691, the population of indigenous Americans had declined by 90 to 95%, or by around 130 million people. Now that number, 130 million deaths, represents both North and South America. But today, according to the Center for Native American Youth at the Aspen Center, there are an estimated 4.5 million individuals in the United States who identify as American Indian or Alaska Native. 4.5 left. That is genocide. That is genocide justified by theology. William Bradford, the Pilgrims, and every other European conqueror who set foot on this continent thought of this land as being theirs because they believed themselves to be God's chosen, the elect with a capital E. At our nation's start, it was the needs and the wants of the European colonizers that mattered, and only them. And the systems and institutions that they established were created to ensure their stranglehold of this continent would continue in perpetuity. The identities that they carried were ensconced in our founding documents, our legal and political systems, and our churches. Not just those institutions, every American institution was founded on the idea that those identities are the right identities. They use religion to justify the systems that they established, and those systems reaffirmed their identities as righteous, and then as they succeeded and prospered, they interpreted it as divine favor. By the 19th century, this had developed into Manifest Destiny and the Doctrine of Discovery, which meant that anywhere a white Protestant man went was his by divine right, so long as it hadn't already been claimed by another white Protestant man, because only white Protestant men matter. Those of us who have some or all of those identities today still benefit from these institutions, these systems. And all of us who are gathered here today have inherited the land that they claim. And I know that this is complicated for folks who have recent immigrant identities, person of color identities, descendant of slaves, and I don't mean to paint with too broad a brush here, but to live in the United States is to live on land that is ill-gotten. So what do we do with that? What do we do with that knowledge? What does it mean to be a person who benefits from the colonization of this land who also finds those colonizers deplorable? As much as we may find it objectionable, our lives are built on the brutality of European colonizers and the society that they created. The only way that I can reconcile this is by thinking about being an American in terms of unearned privilege. I got a sneak peek of Tony's reflection for today. And it takes a lot of courage and self-awareness to make a statement like that, which he did very willingly, and I'm so proud of you, Tony, for being willing to go there. I think a lot of people sometimes mistake the word privilege to mean that they did something wrong or that someone else thinks they did something wrong. People especially seem to balk at the phrase unearned privilege. All that means is that you have certain advantages in life that some other people don't have. And those advantages are conferred by society. It's not something that any of us as individuals have control over. It's nothing to be embarrassed about, and there's no reason to feel guilty about the parts of your identity that confer advantages, or to say, I didn't ask to be born, blah, blah, blah. Your guilt and your shame does not erase those advantages. They just get in the way of being able to use those something useful. We all have privilege, although we do not have the same amount of privilege. It is our job as thinking, feeling people to be aware of the privilege that we hold, to be able to name it and know it exists, and then learn how to use it for good. The antidote for an unhealthy relationship with privilege is, in fact, gratitude. Gratitude with a side of humility. We are grateful for the privilege we have, and we are humble enough to make room for marginalized voices. That is when we learn how to use our privilege for good. That is when we can truly work for a world made fair, which I believe we all want. And in a similar way, this is how we, as Unitarian Universalists, reconcile the truth of our past and how we think of ourselves today. The congregational polity that we've inherited from the Mayflower Compact is deeply important to us. It's the cornerstone of the religious freedom that we enjoy in our congregations. But let us remain critical of our past and conscious of our present actions. It's easy to see it when we look back, but can we see it today? How will future generations judge us for our actions or our inaction? In June of the coming year, Unitarian Universalist congregations from around the world will gather for our annual General Assembly in Providence, Rhode Island. This location is significant because next November, a year from now, marks the 400th anniversary of the landing of the Mayflower. We're getting a jump on it. We, as UUs, are in a unique position, both as the spiritual descendants of the pilgrims and as the people who are appalled by the genocide of the indigenous people of this land. As I understand it, a good portion of our General Assembly will be dedicated to wrestling with this complex subject, and there's always a protest time at General Assembly. If you're able to attend, I encourage you to do so. We'll have more information coming out from the office in the following week. Beloved, we have so much to be thankful for. We are not responsible for the actions of our ancestors, but we are responsible for what we do with the incredible advantages that we've inherited. Knowing the painful history of our country and our religious tradition can feel heavy. Feel it in the room right now. It can feel like maybe we shouldn't celebrate Thanksgiving. I assure you, it is okay to celebrate Thanksgiving. But as you gather with your loved ones this year, I encourage you to take a moment and acknowledge this history. Maybe say a few words, recognizing what happened to our indigenous kindred. Maybe say a few words honoring the incredible vibrance, tenacity, and resilience of the Native American community. Today, we have dealt honestly with our tragic past. May our awareness of that past broaden our circle of concern to include all who share with us in life. May it be so.